Now, Mr. Hanegraaff's final question to Mr. Hitchcock. In your dissertation for late dating Revelation, you reference your conviction that the temple that is destroyed in Revelation 11 is not Herod's temple, but, quote, the third Jewish temple that will exist in Jerusalem during the tribulation, unquote. You go on to assert that there will be a fourth, quote, fourth Jewish temple that will exist during the Messianic kingdom, unquote. As such, you hold that Jesus predicted the destruction of the second temple in Matthew 24:2, and then, without warning, begins describing a 21st century tribulation in which a third temple is desecrated. Despite the fact that Jesus never mentioned either a third or a fourth temple, you contend that Jesus will preside over a millennial temple replete with temple sacrifices. Do you, in concert with your colleague, Dr. LaHaye, hold that animal sacrifices in the millennial temple are absolutely necessary to atone for sin, and with your colleague, Tommy Ice, believe that, quote, without animal sacrifices in the millennium, Yahweh's holiness would be defiled, unquote. If so, do not such sacrifices stand in direct opposition to the eternal hope of the Christian faith, namely that Christ's atonement on the cross paid the price for all sins past, present, and future, and is not a return to Old Covenant sacrifices an affront to the holiness of God?
Before you start the clock, I want to make a point about the form of the question. We only have 4 minutes to answer these questions, so we both agreed and signed a contract that each question will just contain one question. It's hard to answer multiple questions in 4 minutes. This question here has three questions here at the end of it. There's three question marks that are given, three separate questions that are asked. It's difficult to do that in this period of time, but I will answer the gist of what this question's about, or these questions are about. So having said that, this is a very tangential issue concerning the date of Revelation. One's view of the millennial temple in Ezekiel 40 to 43 is not a decisive issue for the AD 95 date or any other date for Revelation. So it seems strange to me that Mr. Hanegraaff would make it a focus in this debate. I do mention it in my dissertation, but in dissertations you have to talk about everything. It wasn't a central point. In the afterword to his fiction book, The Last Disciple, Mr. Hanegraaff makes this charitable, ironic statement concerning the authors of the Left Behind series. The point here is not to call into question the orthodoxy of the Left Behind authors. We adhere to the Christian maxim in essentials unity and non-essentials liberty and all things charity. We must debate this issue, but we need not divide over it. In the Apocalypse Code, Mr. Hanegraaff says concerning the dispensational view of Ezekiel 40 to 43, the implications of this theology are as bizarre as they are blasphemous. He repeats the same charge two more times. He also calls dispensationalism a pseudo-eschatology. This sounds like pretty divisive language to me. Many respected scholars hold there'll be a temple and animal sacrifices in the millennial kingdom. Norm Geisler, John MacArthur, Daryl Bach, I just talked to him the other day. He told me that's what he believes. This doesn't prove this view is correct, but it should cause Mr. Hanegraaff to rethink his blasphemous label for us. Number three, Mr. Hanegraaff's questions about a millennial temple and animal sacrifices have been ably answered by Thomas Ice, Jerry Hullinger, Randall Price, John Whitcomb, and Arnold Fruchtenbaum, all of whom I mentioned in my dissertation, and I think all of whom are here other than Jerry Hullinger. Mr. Hanegraaff either chooses to remain ignorant of what has been written on this issue by dispensationalists or continues to knowingly misrepresent it. Number four, is it blasphemous to believe that a temple and sacrifices will once again exist in the millennial kingdom, as Mr. Hanegraaff says? John Schmidt says this. He says, Ezekiel himself believed it was a reality in the future home of the Messiah. Then it becomes not heresy to believe that a temple and sacrifices will exist. Rather, it is almost a heresy not to believe this, especially because it's part of God's infallible word. The burden is on us is to determine how it fits, not its reality. Hullinger, an article I would recommend to all of us, says this. He discusses the Day of Atonement as the background for Hebrews 9 and 10. He says, the blood of Christ achieved what the blood of animals could never nor was intended to achieve, namely internal cleansing resulting in salvation and access. It is obvious from the truths presented in Hebrews that the animal offerings of the Old Testament and offering of Christ were instituted for different purposes, each efficacious on its own restrictive level. When these two atonement realms are grasped, the integrity of Ezekiel's prophecy is maintained, as well as the unique and precious nature of our Lord's sacrifice. This is why it is fitting for sacrifices to be renewed in the kingdom. Their temporal function of dealing with ceremonial defilement will once again be needed due to God's physical presence. This, therefore, is not a step backward because that realm of cleansing once more becomes relevant. Their renewal has nothing to do with encroaching on the realm of Christ's sacrifice. The temple in Ezekiel 40 to 43 is a new covenant temple. We can go back to Jeremiah 31 and other passages, Ezekiel 37. It's not a reversion to the old covenant. My call to Mr. Hanegraaff on this issue is for him to stop the strident blasphemy language. Instead of trying to demonize dispensationalists, brothers in Christ, as blasphemous, why not read what dispensationalists, many of these people I've just mentioned, are actually saying, and thoughtfully interact with the sizable body of scholarship that's out there that's attempting to take both Ezekiel and Hebrews seriously. You've talked earlier about exegeting the Bible and not the church fathers. That is exactly what we're trying to do with Hebrews and with the book of Ezekiel, to take them both seriously and to bring them together in a way that harmonizes the two of them. Thank you.
Well, in response, let me first say that I take that rebuke seriously. I think that to the extent that I used strident language, I apologize, but this is not something that's only gone one way. It's gone both ways. To call me someone who believes that Jesus Christ came back in AD 68 and to have that printed in newspapers was seriously damaging both to me personally and to our ministry. But I take the rebuke, and I don't think that that's any excuse for me to talk about blasphemy. I don't think that Dr. LaHaye is anything but a brother and someone that we can laud as someone who has made a remarkable impact on the historic Christian church. But with respect to the question, you did mention it in your dissertation. I think it is relevant. And my question, even though it was multifaceted, gets down to, is not a return to Old Covenant sacrifices an affront to the holiness of God? The writer of Hebrews explicitly explains that in Christ, the Old Covenant order, including temple sacrifices, are obsolete and would soon disappear. So in place of sacrificing holy cows, we're to celebrate Holy Communion in remembrance of the sacrifice of the Holy Christ.
Now, Mr. Hitchcock's final question to Mr. Hanegraaff. The Lycus Valley, including the city of Laodicea, suffered a devastating earthquake in AD 60 and 60 or 61. How could Jesus say in AD 65 that the Laodiceans were rich and had need of nothing in 317 when it took an entire generation to restore and rebuild the city?
Well, in answer to that question, let me first say that the point here is to contrast Laodicea's material wealth with their spiritual poverty. Just as Laodicea banked on its own physical resources within the context of the physical upheaval of an earthquake, so too Laodicea presumed upon the filthy robes of her own self-righteousness rather than the white robes of the righteousness of the Lord Jesus Christ. And I think in suggesting that this does not fit the context, we should once again think about the context. This is to the angel of the church at Laodicea write. These are the words of the Amen, the faithful and true witness, the ruler of God's creation. I know your deeds, that you are neither cold nor hot. I wish you were either one or the other, but because you are lukewarm, neither hot or cold, I'm about to spit you out of my mouth. You say, I am rich. I have acquired wealth. I do not need a thing. But you do not realize that you are wretched, pitiful, poor, blind, and naked. I counsel you to buy from me gold refined in the fire so that you can become rich, and white clothes to wear so that you can cover your shameful nakedness. Those who I love,
Oh, by the way, and then eye salve to put on your eyes so that you can see. The Laodiceans were exporting Phrygian powder, and the irony is they themselves were spiritually blind. And then the Lord says, those who I love, I rebuke and discipline. So be earnest and repent. Here I am. I stand at the door and knock. If anyone hears my voice and opens the door, I will come in and eat with him and he with me. He who overcomes will have the right to sit with me on my throne, just as I overcame and sat down with my Father on his throne. He who has an ear, let him hear what the Spirit says to the churches. These words obviously make a whole lot of sense, Dr. Hitchcock, within the context of upheaval. They think that they can handle things financially and therefore don't want any money from the imperial treasury. Well, the same problem that they have in terms of their pomp and ceremony with respect to material wealth, Jesus is saying they have with respect to their spiritual condition, which is to say that they are blind, pitiful, poor, wretched, they're naked when they think that they're spiritually clothed. And that's why they are exhorted to buy white robes of the righteousness of Jesus Christ rather than cover themselves with the filthy robes of their own self-righteousness. Now, once again, this interpretation is based not on external evidence. It is simply based on reading Scripture in light of Scripture, because these words echo back to Hosea chapter 12. Where the Jews are rich under Jeroboam II in Ephraim, the northern kingdom. And yet they are spiritually poor and blind, and therefore they are going to suffer this great, great tragedy, which ends up destroying the northern kingdom of Israel. So again, reading Scripture in light of Scripture, I don't think you find any difficulty whatsoever. And this certainly does not preclude the notion of an early dating of the book of Revelation.
1 minute.
The rebuilding of the city of Laodicea, we know, spanned 30 years. Colin Hammer says, apart from the large Hadrianic building, probably a gymnasium, most of the principal edifices whose ruins survive appear to date from the period of earthquake reconstruction. Stadium Amphitheater, AD 79, the Syrian Gate, AD 88 to 90. These gates and towers are considered to have marked the culmination of the rebuilding. The French archaeological reports bear this out. The point is, when would it have been better? 30 years after this earthquake had taken place, they had rebuilt it themselves. They, at that point, are rich. That fits the context a lot better for these people to say, we are rich, we don't have need of anything, than when they're just a few years into a rebuilding process. It's going to take 25 more years. It fits the 95 AD date much better than it fits the 65 date. That's the facts of how long it took to rebuild the city. And again, he talks about comparing Scripture with Scripture. Which one of these scenarios fits better, what the Bible actually says? It fits better if these people have rebuilt the city and are living in splendor.
This concludes this portion of the debate. And now we're going to have the cold question thing, and I figured that wouldn't be good for me to do, so I'm turning this portion over to John Ankerberg. But first, let me say that we will start with a question to Mr. Hanegraaff, and he will have 2.5 minutes to answer, and then Mark will have 1 minute to respond, and then we'll switch to Mr. Hitchcock.
I'm going to ask both of you to stand at the lectern, because we're going to go back and forth quite fast.
All right.
All right. First question from a late date advocate asked Mr. Hank Hanegraaff. A late date advocate asked Mr. Hank Hanegraaff, how can you claim to believe in sola scriptura when you belittle a future pre-trib interpretation of Revelation 3:10, quote, the hour of temptation which shall come upon all the world to try them that dwell upon the earth? When did a worldwide trial of this ultimate magnitude happen in the past?
Well, the first thing that you have to, again, do is interpret Scripture in light of Scripture. In Colossians 1:23, Paul says, the gospel has been proclaimed to every creature under heaven. In Colossians 1:6, we have the indication that the gospel is bearing fruit all over the world. This is obviously talking about the Roman Empire. There are many other examples that can be given. For example, in Acts chapter 2, it has Jews from every nation under heaven in Jerusalem. Now, conversely, take Revelation chapter 3 and try to find a pre-tribulational rapture there. Or try to find a pre-tribulational rapture in John chapter 14, which Dr. LaHaye says is the first teaching of Jesus Christ on the pre-tribulational rapture. It is conspicuous by its absence. And I do not think that Jesus would befuddle a first century church in Philadelphia with something that had nothing to do with them. Read the text. Since you have kept my command to endure patiently, I will also keep you. He's talking to a first century audience. From the hour of trial that is going to come upon the whole earth to test those who live in the earth. Now, the church at Philadelphia would not have thought that Jesus was speaking to them about a 21st century church that they're going to be spared a tribulation via a pre-tribulational rapture. That is reading something into the text that the text simply does not give us.
How long do I have?
1 minute.
1 minute. Well, the text, what it says here, he says, I will keep you not just from the testing. The word ek here means out of or from. I will keep you from the hour of the testing, from the very time itself. It's kind of like if you go to class and you've got an A, you know, and they tell you in the class, you have to show up, but you don't have to take the test. This happens in my kids' classes sometimes. Or what if they say, if you have an A in the class, you don't even have to show up for the hour of testing. He doesn't just say, I'll keep you from the test. I will keep you from the very time of the test, is what he actually says in the text here. That hour which is about to come upon the whole world to test those who dwell upon the earth, the earth dwellers. I think that phrase is used 11 times through the book of Revelation for those who are in a rebellion against God. So that's what I believe that text is actually saying to us, is they're going to be kept from the time. And that is consistent with the pre-trib rapture, when the church will be taken and will be exempt from the very time of testing itself.
All right, the first question for Dr. Mark Hitchcock. Is there any evidence that Patmos was used as a penal colony before 90 AD?
Before 90?
Before 90.
Not that I know of. I don't believe it was used necessarily as a penal colony even after that. I've been there. In fact, Gordon Franz, who's out here just a few rows back, Gordon and I spent about 3 days there a few years ago. And there's evidence there of a temple to Apollo, a temple to Diana, a hippodrome, a large administrative center. I believe that John was just sent there. It seems like from the archaeological evidence that's there, he's just sent there to get him away from the churches there. You know, it's often preachers like to use these illustrations. You know, John was sent out to Alcatraz. You know, we use that illustration, you know, kind of a modern day Alcatraz, you know, this place he was sent to. I don't really see the historical or the archaeological evidence to back that up. Just like, as I said earlier, Eusebius says that, and others do, that Flavia Domitilla was banished by Domitian the very same year of 95 AD to an island called Pandataria. I mean, it was common that they just banish people to an island, not necessarily a penal colony, just to get them away from where they were, just as a punishment. So Patmos, you know, is about 50 miles off the coast there of Ephesus. John evidently was having a lot of influence in the churches there, and so I believe he was simply sent there to a lesson. The influence that he had, of course, according to church history, won a lot of people there to the Lord as well. So, you know, wherever he went, he took this message with him and received the apocalyptic vision there. So I don't see personally any evidence that, you know, the island of Patmos was a, quote, penal colony, before 90 AD or after, just the place John was banished to. And then whenever Domitian was succeeded by Nerva, then Nerva reversed that and allowed John to come back to the area in and around Ephesus, where eventually he died.
Response?
I essentially agree with that. I think the prevailing notion that Patmos was a barren Alcatraz may well be a little more than the imposition of 20th century anachronistic prejudices on first century realities. While John was banished to Patmos by authorities in Asia Minor, he was likely not imprisoned. In fact, he may well have had access to the entire 30-mile circumference of a well-developed island during the entirety of his exile, and he may have stood on the shore while seeing the vision of a beast coming out of the sea. So I would simply take issue with church fathers like Victorinus, who suggest that somehow or other John was in some hard labor in a mine in Patmos when he was somewhere between the ages of 90 and 100 years old, and then according to tradition carries on a fruitful ministry in Ephesus later on. I think that stretches credulity beyond the breaking point.
All right, second question for Mr. Hank Hanegraaff. You have graciously indicated that you are not partial or full preterist. My question is, what are you? Amil, preterist, futurist?
Well, I have laid that out very clearly. I'm surprised that question would be asked. I'm also surprised that we got all kinds of surprises going on here, even in who's asking the questions. But, you know, the issue here is very clear. I've written a whole book indicating that I'm an exegetical eschatologist. And I do not believe in partial preterism. I've said that over and over again. I don't know how many times I have to say that. And to say, as Dr. Hitchcock has just said, that I believe part of the book of Revelation was fulfilled in the past, therefore I'm a partial preterist, is disingenuous. This is simply a wrong. This is a system of interpretation that I don't like. Mm-hmm. Just like a futurist is interpreting Revelation with a newspaper in their hand, the partial preterist is interpreting Revelation with a history book in their hands. And so they're saying that the hailstones that are falling down from the sky, 100-pound hailstones, are really Roman catapults that are being lobbed over the wall into the temple court. I think that is not reading language in the sense in which it's intended to be read. Just in the very same way as I would say that blood rising to the horse's bridles. It's a common first century metaphor. It's a judgment metaphor to suggest, as Dr. LaHaye says, that we have this 5-foot river of blood because the hailstones mix with the blood, and that's how you can get that much blood, I think is simply reading something into the text that's unwarranted. This is judgment language. It was first used in the first century, and it was used many times in the first century. If I say it's raining cats and dogs, it's a metaphor with sharp teeth. I don't mean cats and dogs are falling out of the sky. I mean it's raining hard. I'm not a partial preterist, and Dr. LaHaye, I am not a full preterist. And by the way, with respect to some of this language that you were talking about earlier, strident language, mm-hmm. For you guys to call me viciously anti-Israel, mm-hmm. When my parents were involved in saving Jews during the Second World War, and I have never said a single thing about Israel in a negative way, I think is also divisive.
Response?
Well, Mr. Hanegraaff, in your ministry, you do a lot of labeling of people because it's of value to label people as certain things, as cults or as different groups or dispensationalists or whatever. And you take, the definition of a partial preterist is part of the book of Revelation has been fulfilled. And part of it is future.
That's not the definition.
Doesn't mean it's all been fulfilled, but it's partial.
You know better than that.
It's a partial preterist.
It's a system of interpretation. You know better than to say such a thing.
I understand, and you're saying you don't agree with everything that partial preterists say. I don't agree with everything that all other futurists say. But you take part of the book of Revelation as having already been fulfilled in the past and part of it as future. And In my understanding, that's what makes one a partial preterist. Now, you can define how much of it you think's past and how much of it you think's future. But for someone who has a ministry that's kind of built on labeling people and categorizing people of where they are, you know, I find it strange that you would not be willing to say what you are.
All right, this is the second question for Dr. Mark Hitchcock, and a question from an early date advocate. What did Jesus mean when he said, "This generation shall not pass until all these things come to pass"?
Well, that's a quote, of course, from Matthew 24, which, you know, really has nothing to do with the date of Revelation that we're talking about. But my understanding of this statement that's made here for us in Revelation, or in Matthew chapter 24, verse 33, says, "Even so, you too, when you see all these things, recognize that he's here right at the door." And I take the words "this generation" are controlled by the statement before, which says the people that see all these things. And if you go back up before here, in verse 29, it says, "Immediately after the tribulation of those days, the sun will be darkened, the moon will not give its light, the stars will fall from the sky, the powers of the heavens will be shaken, the sign of the Son of Man will appear in the sky. All the tribes of the earth will mourn, and they will see the Son of Man coming on the clouds of the sky with power and great glory. He'll send forth his angels with a great trumpet. They'll gather together his elect from the four winds, from one end of the sky to the other." And then he goes on down, verse 33, "Even so, when you see all these things, recognize that he is near right at the door. Truly I say to you, this generation," I take it he's saying the generation that sees all these things. So my understanding is that this will be a future generation, a generation of people in the end times that will see these events be unfolded, which if you go back to the question Jesus was asked, "Tell us, will these when will these things be? What will be the sign of your coming in the end of the age?" And so the phrase "this generation," I take it when he says that, refers back to all these things. Also, if you go back to the very beginning of chapter, or the very end of chapter 23, this really sets the whole framework for Matthew 24 when it says, "For I say to you," Jesus says, "from now on you will not see me again until you say, 'Blessed is he who comes in the name of the Lord.'" Which clearly, to me, this passage can't be about the events of AD 70 and them seeing Jesus then, because they didn't say, "Blessed is he who comes in the name of the Lord" at that time. So that's the way I understand, even though it has nothing to do with the date of Revelation, that's my understanding of this generation, which I know is one of the main time texts that others use. I won't say the word preterist, that other people use.
Well, I'd like to respond to that, but I have to respond to what you said previously. To say that I have built a ministry based on labeling people, I knew that I was walking into the lion's den, but I never expected that kind of a statement by you about our ministry. We're a ministry that has, for many, many years, been consistent with trying to make people so familiar with truth that when a counterfeit looms on the horizon, they know it instantaneously, and it's a ministry that has borne abundant, abiding fruit. There are many people that have come into the kingdom as a direct result of the ministry. As far as what I said about exegetical eschatology, I've told you what I am, so you don't have to ask me that question over and over again. I've said very clearly that I do not embrace any extant model of eschatology. I'm more concerned with a proper method with respect to the art and science of biblical interpretation.
All right, the third question for Mr. Hank Hanegraaff. Would you explain why you called Dr. Tim LaHaye a racist in your book?
Well, first of all, again, read the book. I've never called Dr. LaHaye a racist in the book. So get the book, The Apocalypse Code, and someone show me where I called Dr. LaHaye a racist. I've never said that. What I say is that God is neither a racist or a land broker, which is to say that God does not put people on different footings. Throughout the entire Bible, God has had one covenant community,
made of people from every tongue and tribe and language and people and nation. And this is as true in the Old Testament as it is in the New. Ruth was a Moabite, the arch enemy of Israel, and yet in a privileged position in the lineage of Jesus Christ, not because of her DNA or her birth mother, but because she believed in Yahweh, the God of Israel. If you read Esther chapter 8, the last verse, the nations look on and see the sovereign power of God in raising Esther up to save the Jews. And the text says, on that day, many different people from many different nations became Jews. Now, they didn't change their DNA or their birth mother. They believed in Yahweh, the God of Israel. And it was accounted to them as their being true Israel. And yet, on the other hand, Revelation tells us there are those who claim to be Jews, but are not. They are a synagogue of Satan. True Israel is not determined on the basis of your race. And it certainly isn't done on the basis of a personality profile. So you can't look at Jacob and say, as Dr. LaHaye said, he's a dead ringer for the modern day Jews. It's not the way in which true Israel is determined. It's determined not by the circumcision of the flesh, but the circumcision of the heart. Talking about true Israel, one covenant community, and that one covenant community is beautifully illustrated by Paul in Romans chapter 11 by a cultivated olive tree, which encompasses both Jews and Gentiles.
Response?
Well, I'm a dispensationalist, and I do believe in a distinction between Israel and the church. I believe God made promises to Israel. But again, if you do exegetical eschatology in the Old Testament, promises that haven't been fulfilled. I believe in the New Testament, Jesus said, I will build my church, something that had not existed before. It's called a mystery, something that had not been revealed before in the book of Ephesians. There's the baptism of the Holy Spirit, which is a new thing that God had not done before. The church has its birthday on the day of Pentecost, and I believe that God has a distinct program from the church that began at the day of Pentecost suddenly, and we'll end at the rapture suddenly as well. If you go back to the Old Testament covenants, they were not fulfilled literally in Old Testament Israel. And if God is going to keep his word to the nation of Israel, these unconditional, eternal, unilateral covenants will be fulfilled in the future. So I believe there's a distinction between Israel and the church, which is the essence of what is the definition of a dispensationalist.
All right, this is the third question for Dr. Mark Hitchcock. From what you have heard tonight from Mr. Hank Hanegraaff, what eschatological view, position, do you believe he is presenting?
Well, I think I've already stated that. Again, he says that he is not interested in outcome, he's interested in method. But methods have outcomes. How we interpret the Bible necessarily leads to outcomes. You can't have a method and just say, I just have a method, but this method doesn't lead to outcome. So you have to have an outcome, and your outcome is gonna fit into some pigeonhole. I mean, there's enough pigeonholes out there in eschatology of, you know, your view of the millennium. You know, you're the amillennial, or you're premillennial, or you're postmillennial. I mean, those pretty much encompass the ideas that people can have on this. So. To me, again, I think that you know, when you say you just have a method, I think everybody has a model, and I think we should share with people what our method is. We should also share with people what are the results that come out of that method. What is the model that comes forth from it? Because really, when you take other areas of theology. We have models in other areas of theology. We don't just have method. We have models for our soteriology. We have models for our ecclesiology. We have models for every of the main areas of theology that we study. And to me, to say that we have a basic model, again, that doesn't mean we agree with everybody. The basic model that I follow, there are differences of opinion. That's why we have this conference. Within our model, there are differences of opinion. So I think to say that is not saying that you agree with every person that holds to that model. But to me, I don't see why we can't have a method and then see that that method inevitably leads to some model. It leads to something that we believe about the future.
Well, if I disagree with the partial preterist system of interpretation, as you well know, why in the world would you then call me a partial preterist? And to say that the amillennial, postmillennial, and premillennial categories pretty much exhaust the categories for the millennium simply isn't true. The millennium doesn't have to deal with a duration of time either between the first and second comings of Jesus Christ or a semi-golden age for 1,000 years after the second coming of Christ. There are a lot of possibilities. 1,000 can be interpreted in the same sense that's interpreted throughout the scriptures. God owns the cattle on 1,000 hills, has little to do with cattle and even less to do with hills, has everything to do with the fact that God owns everything. So 1,000 is a quality of vindication for the martyrs. And if you want to press this language into a literal wooden labyrinth, you've got a lot of difficulties, because the only people that get into the millennium are martyrs, and not just martyrs, but those who are beheaded as martyrs.
All right, we have time for just a question and response and a question and response. So the fourth question for Mr. Hank Hanegraaff is submitted by a late-date advocate who asks, are there any extra-biblical histories written, such as Josephus, that mention anyone having been required to take the mark of the beast during Titus's siege and destruction of Jerusalem in 70 AD? Certainly Titus and all the Roman army would have had the mark if preterism is correct.
Well, this again gets back to how you read the scriptures for all they're worth. The mark of the beast is not a silicone chip. It's not Sunday worship. The mark of the beast is simply how it's described in scripture in contrast to what the mark of Christ is. We're told that if we are believers, we have the mark of Christ. In the Old Testament, the mark on the forehead and the mark on the hand are communicated over and over again. And this is not to be taken in a wooden literal sense, such as if you belong to Christ, you are marked on your forehead with his name and with the name of the Lamb, as though Jesus Christ is a magic marker in mind. No, the forehead represents your worldview, what you believe. The hand represents what you do. And what you believe and what you do identifies you as to who you belong to, such that there's no need for a physical mark. You should know immediately whether you are marked as one who belongs to the bride or marked as one who belongs to the beast. It should be evident by your worldview. You don't need to have a physical mark. People should be able to identify you as believers as a result of your witness and what you do with your life to extend the kingdom of the Lord Jesus Christ.
When Revelation 13, Mr. Hanegraaff takes the idea of 666 literally, that it literally equals Neron Caesar, and he takes the 42 months there literally. The word here, mark, is the word karagma, that refers to a tattoo or an etching or a brand upon someone. What he's referring to, I think, when you're talking about the seal of God on their foreheads, the seal in chapter 7 is the word sphrigizo. It can be used metaphorically. You know, we've been sealed with the Holy Spirit. But it's a different word here. They're going to receive the mark either on the right hand or on the forehead. And the word here, epi, with the genitive, means it's going to be upon the right hand or upon the forehead. And so I take this as a literal mark that's going to be placed upon people in the end times when this final world ruler comes to power. That's what the word mark means.
All right, last question. This is for Dr. Mark Hitchcock. Would you clarify how you see the difference between the Old Testament prophetic literature and Revelation in how they handle history?
And how they handle what?
History.
How the Old Testament prophets?
Would you clarify how you see the difference or differences between the Old Testament prophetic literature and the book of Revelation in how they handle history.
Well, I mean, in the Old Testament, you have many, many prophecies that are given. Those prophecies that are given in the Old Testament are literally fulfilled. There's some symbolic language, but the symbols there have a referent that's a literal referent. Like in the book of Daniel, you have four kingdoms that are mentioned under the image of the imagery of this great statue, or these beasts that come forth. Those things are literally fulfilled. And I would see in the book of Revelation that when you have symbolic language used, like you do in the Old Testament, that it's not a symbol of nothing, it's a symbol that has a literal referent. And the same way in the Old Testament, that frequently the prophet himself would tell you what things mean. You didn't have to go outside of the context. Daniel says, you know, you Nebuchadnezzar, you're the head of gold. After you, there'll be another kingdom. So there's explanation there. The same thing I see in the book of Revelation. Jesus tells us what the seven lampstands are, who the seven stars are. In Revelation 12, we're told what specific things there are. So I wouldn't see a lot of differences in that, in the way it's handled in the Old Testament and in the book of Revelation. I'm not really sure what the question there is driving at. If I could talk with the person, maybe they could make it a little bit more clear exactly what they're driving at, but anyway, that'd be my answer.
Response?
Yeah, I just would add to that I think it's very clear. If you look at the book of Revelation, it's 404 verses, 278 are direct or at least allusions to Old Testament verses. So in order to understand what John is saying, you have to have some kind of an understanding of the Old Testament scriptures. But beyond that, I think it's incredibly important to realize that the whole of the Bible uses language that is not able to be pressed into a wooden literal labyrinth. The fact of the matter is you always have to read things in the sense in which they're intended, and that's ultimately the literal principle of biblical interpretation. It's taking things in the sense in which they're intended. It's reading it as literature.
Thank you, gentlemen. At this time, we're going to go into the closing arguments, and Mark Hitchcock will be first. He'll have 7 minutes for his closing argument.
We began this debate by noting that Mr. Hanegraaff's entire eschatological scheme stands or falls based on his ability to prove that Revelation was written in AD 65. He must prove this fact by a preponderance of the evidence for his view of the book of Revelation to even get out of the starting gate. The burden of proof rests squarely on him to overthrow the traditional AD 95 date. Has he met this burden by a preponderance of the evidence? I think the answer is no. He has no clear external witnesses for his view till over 400 years after Revelation was written. And his first witness is a superscription in a Syriac version of the New Testament. Mr. Hanegraaff's three towers from the internal evidence, I believe, are easily brought down. We've talked about these several times, so I won't go through those again. There are clear reasons why the AD 95 date of Revelation has been the clear, accepted, traditional, dominant date in the church for 1900 years. This is not an accident that this has been the dominant view this long. The external evidence for the AD 95 date, really, I would say, and others have said this as well, so it isn't just me that it's overwhelming. Mr. Hanegraaff may try to argue that it's irrelevant or that all these giants of the early church were mistaken, but let's be honest, if Mr. Hanegraaff had Irenaeus, Clement of Alexandria, Origen, Tertullian, Victorinus, Eusebius, Jerome, and Primasius making statements in favor of the AD 65 date of Revelation, or even had one such witness, he'd be using them and declaring the early date of Revelation as an open and shut case. Again, Irenaeus, born and raised in Smyrna, one of the places where the book of Revelation first appeared, discipled by Polycarp. Polycarp's a disciple of John, wrote the great work Against Heresies. There is no one that I can think of in the early church in a better position to know when Revelation was written than Irenaeus. And his statement is clear. Moreover, as we've seen, Mr. Hanegraaff consistently uses witnesses such as Irenaeus and Eusebius to prove the historical accuracy of the New Testament and other events in early church history, such as who wrote Revelation and the deaths of Peter and James. To me, it's inconsistent to criticize and question the credibility of the very same witnesses that you use in almost all of your other books to support the historical accuracy of the New Testament. Again, here's the statement of Irenaeus. It would have been announced by him who beheld the apocalyptic vision, for that, the nearest antecedent is the apocalyptic vision, was seen no very long time since, but almost in our day, towards the end of Domitian's reign. This is not a markedly ambiguous statement. The first person we know of to say that this is ambiguous and referred to something other than the book of Revelation was in 1752 by Johann Jacob Wettstein. Interestingly, a German preterist, the first one to come up with this. Again, here's the evidence. You all are probably tired of seeing this chart, but here it is one last time. You have the witnesses here, the external witnesses for the AD 95 date, and then the first witness, a Syriac superscription in 508, 616, and then a couple of other late witnesses. That's it. Now, again, if you just had one or two of these people saying this, you know, we could wonder about it. But when you have this line of people, one after another, saying the same thing, Hanegraaff says, you know, these men are wrong about some other things. That is true. Sometimes they are wrong about other things. But when you have all of them agreeing on the same thing, men from widely diverse geographical areas. It's not like all these guys lived in the same place, saying the same thing. I think we would be short-sighted not to give it great credibility. What's the internal evidence for the traditional AD 95 date? Again, I'll go through these points. John did not arrive in Asia until the mid to late 60s AD. F.F. Bruce, in his book New Testament History, discusses this point. There is no overlap of the ministry of John and Paul in Asia. Again, if the letters to the seven churches are written to these churches in Asia Minor in 65 AD, they overlap with 1st and 2nd Timothy. 1st and 2nd Timothy don't mention Nicolaitanism. John doesn't mention Paul. Paul doesn't mention John, which you'd think in the last of 2nd Timothy, Paul has a long list of all these people. You'd think he'd list John there. John was still alive and functioning in that area. The severe spiritual decline of five of the seven churches. Again, not one of them, but in less than 10 years, five of them are in such terrible spiritual decline. They're dead. Christ wants to vomit them out of his mouth, and so on. To me, again, that argues for a time period much later than 65 AD. The church of Smyrna, according to Polycarp, didn't come into existence until after 62 AD. The Lycus Valley earthquake of AD 60 in Laodicea fits a lot better with a 95 date than a 65 date. Number six, Domitian banished Christians as Christians. He banished Flavia Domitilla in 95 AD to an island. Same thing he did with John. And Antipas of Pergamum was martyred in AD 92, which obviously can't have been written earlier. Why would someone base his entire eschatology, his interpretation of the book of Revelation, on a historical fact that at the very best is improbable and at worst is untenable? A view that requires him to dismiss the clear statements of some of the weightiest witnesses in the early church and explain away clear internal indicators that point to a time for Revelation much later than AD 65. Why build your entire eschatological system on the sandy foundation of a view that's been the minority view of the church for 1900 years and is still the minority view today? I urge Mr. Hanegraaff to adopt a view of the book of Revelation that's not dependent on this cracked foundation. Mr. Hanegraaff has failed to meet the burden of proof for the AD 65 date of Revelation. The preponderance of the external and internal evidence favors the traditional AD 95 date. Therefore, the traditional AD 95 date of Revelation stands firm, and Mr. Hanegraaff's eschatological scheme falls. Thank you very much.
I knew I was walking into the lion's den. I didn't know that the lions would be so ferocious. To call my position a scheme, I think, is not what it is at all. It's not as though I'm scheming something or I've devised a scheme. I have a position based on spending hours and hours memorizing scripture. To say that I haven't given any evidence against Dr. Hitchcock's position simply isn't true. I mentioned Clement of Alexandria. It's kind of interesting to know a little more about the reason Clement of Alexandria was on his chart as a late dater. The only evidence that he can set forth is that somehow or other the word tyrant was mentioned, and tyrant has to refer to Domitian and can't refer to Nero. I think we should be done with this revisionistic history that Nero was some kind of a wimpy emperor who fiddled while Rome burned. He may have sung and swooned in maniacal madness, but he certainly did not fiddle. To hold Dr. Hitchcock to his own literalistic standards, the fiddle wasn't even invented until several centuries later. But Clement of Alexandria, a second century father, and I quoted this previously, said Revelation ceased at the time of Nero. As such, the canon would have had to be completed during the reign of Nero. Clement of Alexandria, I don't think, should be on his list. I think he should be on my list if I were making lists. The spiritual decline, not being able to happen with vast rapidity, simply defies what the scripture tells us. Think of what Paul said, in the presence of God and of Christ Jesus, who will come to judge the living and the dead. I give you this charge, preach the word, be prepared in season and out of season, correct, rebuke, and instruct with great patience and careful instruction. For the time will come when men will not endure sound doctrine. Even from among your own numbers, men will arise and distort the truth in order to draw away disciples after themselves. So be on your guard. Remember, for 3 years I never stopped warning you, night and day with tears. If you read through the New Testament, you see that error and apostasy encroached on the church very, very early. And certainly we see that in early church history as well. I haven't had any response whatsoever to the fathers teaching baptismal regeneration, or the perpetual virginity of Mary, or the demonization of Jews in the centuries following the death of Christ. The fact of the matter is, spiritual decline happens rapidly. I was born in Holland. You can look at Holland, which was one of the great lands of the Reformation, which is an apostate nation today, completely against everything that we stand for as believers. So I do not think that the AD 65 date has been disproven. I think the internal evidence points to the AD 65 date, and there are lots of people that hold to that dating. I mentioned the fact that Josh McDowell quotes John A.T. Robinson, who says that we have to seriously consider the dating of the book of Revelation, wrote a tome entitled Redating the New Testament. So I think there's lots of evidence from credible scholarship on both sides of the issue, and therefore we don't need to use demeaning language. And to the extent that I have done that in any sense, I sincerely ask and will ask the person who I've offended for forgiveness. Because I think that this, at the end of the day, needs to be a collegial debate, iron sharpening iron. Now, is it true that I do not like the dispensational position? Yes. I don't think that God has two distinct people with two distinct plans, two distinct destinies, necessitating two phases of the second coming, where you have a secret coming and then a second coming. I do not think that two-thirds of the Jews that have been herded into the Holy Land are going to die in an apocalypse in the very near future, which Dr. LaHaye eerily refers to as the time of Jacob's trouble, or Antichrist's final solution to the Jewish problem. I believe that the Jews are not in the 21st century under any kind
of biblical prescription for some kind of a Holocaust in the future. Nor do I believe in a semi-golden age with rebuilt temple and reinstituted temple sacrifices, and to say, as Dr. LaHaye says, that those temple sacrifices atone for sin, I think is, at the end of the day, not that he means this, but the logical conclusion of that is the sufficiency of Christ's atonement on the cross is being impugned. Either Christ atoned for all sins on the cross or he didn't. And today we have Holy Communion, and we celebrate that for the remembrance of what Christ did for us, his broken body and shed blood for the complete remission of sins. To suppose that we're going to revert back to temple sacrifices when the ultimate sacrificial lamb has come, I think is a position that is untenable. And therefore, I think it's a position that is worth questioning. The late date has a lot to say about what is going to happen in the future, and I think what is projected to happen in the future is something that is going to happen in the past. At the end of the day, however, I look forward to the time when the Lord will return with a loud command, with the voice of the archangel, and with the trumpet call of God, and the dead in Christ will rise. We are still alive, we'll be transformed, we'll meet him in the air, and we will be with the Lord forever.
Thank you. Thank you, gentlemen. That ends the debate.